But there is another war going on in the Middle East that is horrendously neglected for reasons that are beyond my ken. We're very lucky in that Judith here has been a good stalwart member of our group for many years, and she's also got first-hand experience with the Yemen. She went out there in 1998 to work for the United Nations Refugee Council.
Yeah.
And she's got good friends out there, best friends, to manage to help her to get up to Malaysia with her children. So, and Judith also runs the Yemen News Today page, which is well worth looking up on Facebook. So, all hail Judith.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me, Adam, and it's my pleasure to be here and talk about my favourite place, which is Yemen. When I first went out to Yemen in 1998, I was very drawn by the culture and the people, and I think the strange thing was that it actually reminded me of the culture that I was brought up in just after the war, which was a working class area in a poor part of UK. And the sort of like the community feeling sort of immediately after the war, where people were sort of like pulling together, that society doesn't exist anymore. But in a funny way, when I went to Yemen, I could actually sense that it was that same sort of society, and there isn't many people who have the chance to move back into a society that's so much like the society of the Charter. So it was a sort of privilege to be there. And Yemeni people are very hospitable and welcoming, it's part of their culture to be like that. And they suck people into their lives, and that was what I felt happened. And I just fell in love with Yemen. I loved the weather in the winter. It's just perfect, sunny days all the time. It's cold in the evening, maybe freezing point. No clouds in the sky, and it rains in the summer, so every time it starts getting too hot, the rains come down and it cools down. So it's just really, really perfect weather. And then the place itself. Yemen used to be one of the richest countries in the world. Apart from China, it's the land that has the longest... Is that all right?
Yeah.
It's the longest existing civilization that's had the same name and been more or less within the same boundaries for thousands of years. So apart from China, it's the oldest sort of continuously inhabited land with the same name. And then it used to control the Silk Route, the trade routes. Its position, if you can think of the block of Asia, Africa, and Europe, Yemen actually sits in the middle of that block and on the edge of the Red Sea. So it was a good place for sea routes and for land routes. And so it controlled the frankincense trade. It was also the only coffee provider in the world, exporting through their port called Mocha, which is why you think of Mocha coffee. And it was a very, very rich country indeed. But then eventually it lost its wealth, and they had these fantastic houses that had been built when the civilization was rich and knowledgeable. And then when the society became poor, they couldn't knock the buildings down and replace them because they couldn't afford to. So they stayed living in these buildings, some of which were thousands of years old. I think the oldest in Sada that was still inhabited were 4,000 years old. In Sana, where I was, it was 800 to 2,500 years old in Sana city. But when people are living in these old societies that have been there so long in the same houses, with them comes like a phenomenal amount of knowledge of how that society is structured and how it works. So though it's not just the buildings, it's sort of like you've got these living museums. And when you were walking through Yemen, you had the feeling that you were living in something that had existed for so long, and you just felt so privileged to be there and to be part of it. And if I can just... explain a bit about Yemen. I don't know whether you can see this map, but it sits at the bottom of the Arabian Peninsula. Saudi Arabia sits at the top of it and Oman to that side. But if I'm going to talk in some ways about the old North Yemen and the old South Yemen. Funnily enough, the old North Yemen is actually on the west, and the old South Yemen is actually on the east. So North Yemen is actually this mountainous bit here, and South Yemen is this area, which consists of Hadramaut, which largely has not been too involved in the war, but this bit has just been incredibly involved in the most ferocious war that I think the world has ever seen. When I say the ferocious war, after 5 months of war in August, Stephen O'Brien gave a report to the UN Security Council in which he said that there'd been as much damage in Yemen after 5 years as there'd been in 5 months as there'd been in Syria in 5 years, which gives you some idea of how sort of like ferocious and how much damage is happening in Yemen. And literally whole cities have been knocked down. But to go back to the start of the war, I think one can go back as far as you like, because there's so many different strands in Yemen that have actually led to the situation that we've got now. But I was there in 2011, at the time that Yemen had its Arab Spring, so-called. And I think that was sort of heralded the start of the war that we've got now. Saleh, who'd been the president for 33 years, and was a very charismatic man who'd managed to sort of like manipulate people and sort of like keep tribes on his side. But he was also a very sort of corrupt man, and when he sort of like left his presidency, they allowed him to take all of his wealth with him, which was 60 billion, I think, which was half the wealth of Yemen that he took at the time that he left the president's power, and he didn't agree to go immediately. He was very wily in sort of like in thwarting the people who were demonstrating. I was actually in Aden at the time. When the first person was killed, I was staying in a place called Mansoura, and the first person that was killed in the Arab uprising was in Mansoura. And actually, just outside the house where I was, the second, third, fourth, and fifth people were killed. And we were in the house, we could hear what was going on, we could smell the cordon as people were being killed outside. So Saleh managed to hang on to the onto power nonetheless, but the following year, after he'd been involved in an attack in which he was nearly killed, he agreed to stand down and hand over to his deputy, whose name was Hadi, and that was the start of the trouble, really. Hadi, I think that Saleh thought that Hadi would do his will and would, you know, run everything for him in his name, but Hadi had his own ideas and thought that he quite liked being president and he'd like to continue being president. He was elected in an election that only had one person as interim president for a term of 2 years, which expired in 2014, which was then extended for another year. And during this time, the Yemen people had what they called a national dialogue conference, in which all the different parties were meant to come together and decide how Yemen was going to be run and what its new constitution was going to be. And after that, there was going to be elections. And that was the plan. And everybody was saying, oh, all other countries have all started fighting, but Yemen is doing it a different way. It's not going to fight. However, things changed. After the NDC results, there were two groups in Yemen that had been very sort of marginalised and oppressed. One was the Old South, which had unified with North Yemen in 1990, thought it was a bad deal and wanted to get out of it almost straight away, had a civil war in 1994 to try and get their independence and had lost, and had felt that they'd been under occupation ever since then. And then there was the northwest corner of Yemen, which was a tribe called the Bakils, and from which the Houthis that you might have heard of originated. But they used to be the rulers of Dubai for 900 years. For 900 years, Yemen had a king. It was always from the Bakil tribe because they were descendants of the Prophet Muhammad. And they were overthrown in the 1960 revolution in Yemen, and for various reasons they'd been marginalised and been oppressed by Salah, and also sometimes by Saudi Arabia, who'd come in and had a little battle with them as well. And although it wasn't significant in Yemen and wasn't actually ever talked about, but they actually were Shia Muslims. Zaydis. When I say Shia Muslims in Yemen, it was never significant because they worshipped at the same mosque, intermarried. It was a total. Yeah, everybody identified themselves by their tribe, by the village that they came from. Religion was not anything that people used for an identifying cause. But for Saudi Arabia, who's got very touchy over Shia, it had become an issue for them, and unfortunately now this division is for the first time in over 900 years is also an issue in the whole of Yemen too. So these two tribes were marginalised. They go to the dialogue conference. They're not allowed to address their grievances. I mean, for example, people from the south said that. That they were put into groups to talk about things like national security, whereas they actually wanted to talk about southern issues. The Houthi leaders, three of them were assassinated during the time of the NDC, three of them obviously the brightest leaders of the Houthis. So there were tensions. And after the results of the NDC came out, both the South and the Houthis didn't feel that genuine grievances had been addressed in the outcomes of the conference. So the UN envoy was started to negotiate. The Houthis, who by that time had formed a militia, were Yemen's a very tribal society, and militias can come out of any tribe. So they'd formed a militia. They'd joined with another tribe, the Hashids, and they were the two biggest tribes in Yemen, and they took over a lot of the north of Yemen, and then eventually they walked into the capital, Sana'a. Hadi, who was running the government, was very unpopular by that time, and so they came into Sana'a unopposed. Jamal Banawa, the UN envoy, was negotiating a peace agreement, reached a peace agreement in which there was going to be a five-man panel headed by Hadi until elections, and then Hadi suddenly ran away to Riyadh and asked them to bomb Yemen, which they very obligingly have done ever since. If one city, Sada, which is the home city of the Houthis and the Bakils, has had, I looked up today, 42,000 bombs so far in one city. They have bombs every single day. The city itself has been totally flattened. I'm not quite sure what the bombing. They do bomb the IDPs. They do say that they warned people that to get out of their houses before they bombed them by dropping notes telling them we're going to bomb you tomorrow. But where can they actually go? They've bombed the petrol stations. They've bombed everything else. It's a desert, high mountains. Where can they go? So they take some things out of the house to make up a makeshift tent on the side of the road and living in it, and that's largely what they're doing. 2 million displaced people at the moment, or that's an estimate, there may even be more, at which it's estimated only 15% are receiving any help whatsoever. Most of the North Yemen has not had electricity at all since August, and there's because of that, they can't pump water, and so there aren't clean water supplies. And in fact, there's very little water because there's no groundwater in Yemen except when it rains for two short periods in the summer. So water is a serious issue because there is a Saudi-led blockade which is stopping any boats getting in or out of Yemen. And would you believe our government is, our Navy is helping them, as is the United States Navy, as is the French, who are actually enforcers meant to be checking all the ships to see whether there are any weapons on the ships before they're coming to Yemen. But the result is that a nation that was already one of the poorest nations in the world is now, it used to import 90% of its foodstuffs. It's now in crisis. They've been saying it's been in crisis for a long time. They say that the North Yemen, this bit on this side of Yemen, and most of it is what they call severe acute food insecure. 500,000 children are suffering from severe malnutrition. Most hospitals aren't functioning because A, they haven't got any fuel to run electricity. A lot of the staff have left because they can't live in Yemen. And so if you're a doctor and you can get out, then you know, you look after your family and go. Not any medicine or medical, very little medicine and medical equipment coming in, and so these children that have severe malnutrition don't have a very good chance of surviving it because there isn't a sufficient medical care. Relating to the deaths, I personally think that the death count is extremely low because I hear of number of deaths every single day, but the death count never seems to rise. But the reason for that is because the deaths are only counted if they're counted in hospital. The official statistics come from hospital records. Unfortunately, they've destroyed so many hospitals, 51 to date, and also lots of the others aren't functioning, so people can't get to the hospital. And quite honestly, if a bomb drops on your house and you can see all of your family in bits, then you don't need anyone to tell you that they've died. You take them and bury them so they don't get into the death certificates, the statistics, which are ridiculously low considering the amount of damage that's been going on. And of course, there's also an incredible lot of wounded people. I saw a video that made me weep yesterday of a little three-year-old girl where a bomb had dropped on her house and killed family members, destroyed her house, took away a leg. And ICRC, the Red Cross, have fitted her with an artificial leg, and she was sort of like overjoyed to be on her feet again. And I was just so moved by it, and how she has such courage. And there are stories like that that you hear about all the time. So the war itself, there are various fronts on which there are ground wars. The Houthis are fighting with most of the Yemen army on their side. Some of the Yemen army have sided with Hadi and the Yemeni coalition, and they've been bolstered by, I think, 10,000 new Yemeni troops that have been trained in Saudi Arabia, and the UAE are also training more at the moment. But obviously, with no employment, everything has stopped in Yemen. Nobody's able to work because there's no electricity. So unemployment being so low, it's actually drawing people to fighting armies and, of course, driving a lot of young men whose schools are stopped and don't have any hope for the future. It's also driving them to the militias. The Houthi militias have increased, so have Al-Qaeda. Interestingly, Al-Qaeda and ISIS are openly fighting on the Saudi side in Yemen. It's said that some of the, when the Russians started bombing in Syria, that they actually bought, Emirates bought some of the people who are fighting in ISIS to Yemen. They may well have been Yemenis that were returning to Yemen because a lot of the Yemenis went to fight there. I don't know that exactly, but Al-Qaeda, for example, there was an interview on Al Jazeera which said that that Saudi had actually asked Al-Qaeda to control Makalla port, which is a port facing the south of Yemen, at the time that they started their aerial bombardment, because obviously what they didn't want was for the Houthis to be able to import weapons or even to be able to import food. So Al-Qaeda helped the Fort of Makalla, and they're also now, since the Houthis have been driven from Aden, they're also holding Aden, and so large parts of the southwest and central south are actually now under the control of Al-Qaeda, as are large bits of the desert area on the left, Hadramaut. So our government knows about it. It's very easy to see. Every few days you're sent a little video clip of sort of like somebody in a yellow jeep and a black flag driving past a checkpoint in Aden. It's pretty obvious that it's happened. So I don't quite know what our government thinks, because if it's going to fight to kill people in ISIS, I'm not sure quite why they're providing weapons to Saudi Arabia who are fighting on the same side as ISIS in Yemen. It all seems to be a bit of a strange policy to me. All of the militias that are fighting are absolutely vicious. There's no doubt about it. The Houthis are vicious, and in effect, I think as soon as the Saudi bombs started dropping, the people who were fighting on the side of Saudi Arabia against the North, the Southern Secessionists, for example, they took heart and started fighting more viciously. The Houthis were sort of like thinking that, you know, Saudi was going to destroy them, so they fought more viciously. So it actually acted as sort of like a catalyst to the sort of like viciousness. And this war has been totally, completely and utterly barbaric. If you think of a town like Taiz at this moment in time, it's suffering Saudi bombs. A friend of mine sent a picture to say that his father's house was damaged in Taiz yesterday. They suffer sort of like sniping from the Houthis. They also suffer from the different militias, Islam militias and Salafist militias that are fighting the Houthis, who've got missiles sort of like shooting at each other. They've got the nationwide Saudi-led blockade plus a local added-on blockade by the Houthis in Taiz. They're really suffering absolutely in a way that you can't believe or understand that it can happen. And that's one town. In Saada, everything's gone. People are living in displaced camps, and every day they have bombs falling. In Yemen, in the capital, a lot of it has actually been wiped out. Hadda Street, the equivalent of Oxford Street, has gone. The old city of Sana'a, a 2,500 years inhabited city, parts of that have been destroyed. It's a UNESCO World Heritage Site. But nobody says anything. They talk about Palmyra, not so old and also not occupied, but you know, at the same time as the bombs were falling on Sana'a, and it wasn't even mentioned in the media. It was just so beautiful. We lived really close to it when we were there, and it was just, you know, it's just heartbreaking when you hear of these sorts of things happening. 85% of Yemeni population are in need of humanitarian aid, according to the latest UN statistics. In certain provinces, sort of in the Tahama down by the Red Sea, there are populations on the move because of the lack of food. I haven't seen anything at all about it in the media. I've spoken to people like, for example, I spoke to an engineer a couple of days ago. Well, when I say spoke, I contacted him via messenger, who said, look, Judith, he used to be a project engineer. He's a highly qualified engineer with a master's degree and a previous good job. Of course, nobody works in Yemen. He said to me, look, Judith, I've got 4 children. They can't go to school because their school's being destroyed. I haven't got any money. I haven't got any work. If I stay here, we're all going to die, and I've just got to get out. I now feel that I've almost become the emigration officer for Yemen, because I know other people have gone through different routes, and they tell me how they got to Jordan, how they got to Kuala Lumpur, what the situation was there, how they could get work. I sort of like advise people how they can get on master's degrees and look at university applications. So I feel that I'm sort of like the emigration officer for Yemen, advising people on how to leave. But when I was there, I never heard a single person ever, despite the poverty, ever want to leave. They, in fact, you know, they were always so proud of being Yemeni, and Yemen was where they wanted to be, whatever happened. So to hear these heartbreaking stories now, and people who want to leave, people from all walks of life, accountants, teachers, army officers, just so many people who tell me that they just don't feel that they can survive there any longer. And so that's the sad thing about Yemen. I think there are definite links with Israel. Interestingly, there were four meetings between the foreign ministers of Israel and Saudi Arabia before the war, with photographs that are reported, so I believe that they happened. And also, lots of newspapers reported that Prince Walid, who's one of the Saudi princes, went to Jerusalem in June this year. And those meetings are sort of quite well publicised. I think there's lots of sort of like characteristics between Yemen and Gaza. The fact that people are trapped in, it's very difficult for them to get out because they've got Saudi on the top. I've seen photographs of people, desperate people from the war, trying to escape through the Saudi border and the Saudi guards shooting at them. On the east side is Al-Qaeda. It would be life-threatening to go there, so nobody wants to do that. And then there's the sea, which is a very effective blockade aided by the government. At one point, people used to be able to catch a boat from the corner of Yemen, Bab al-Mandeb, but now over to Somalia and Djibouti. I think that route is much more difficult now because Bab al-Mandeb is being held by the UAE, but I don't, since they've left, I'm not sure. Mercenaries, I think Saudi and UAE have decided they don't want to continue fighting because there's so many of their fighters being killed. Would you believe the Janjaweed militias are going there? 10,000 of them? Which, you know, and the president of Sudan, who's still wanted, I think, for genocide, is taken 2.2 million to send sort of like militias from Sudan to fight in Yemen. There's 1,800 mercenaries from South America being paid for by UAE, who are training them at the moment because they didn't want their soldiers killed either. So it seems like there's this policy now of rich countries that can afford it, sort of like paying poor countries to fight, so poor countries have a vested interest in the war continuing in Yemen, as indeed do our countries. £1.3 billion worth of munitions bought for Saudi Arabia to drop on Yemen last week. So it seems like there's lots of vested reasons for people to continue killing Yemenis, most of whom no longer want the war, even if they wanted it in the first place. The majority of them now just want to live in peace. One man actually said to me a few months ago, I wouldn't care now if I was ruled by Israel as long as it was peaceful, and that, for a Yemeni, is quite an admission. So there's lots of similarities between Israel, and in fact, this week, I think they're calling it a mission because they're not calling it officially calling it an embassy, but a mission, it is an embassy, has opened in UAE, Saudi mission, I don't know whether you heard about that. And also the foreign minister of Saudi has said that they think that it's about time that they develop better relationships with Israel, so the relationship that's been going on in a clandestine way, I think, is now going to be more open to the future. And what's the future for Yemen? There's meant to be peace process, but the difficulty is Hadi. Everybody has said that they'll go to the peace process, but Hadi are prevaricating. because he knows he's extremely unpopular. Who's going to vote for him? He wasn't popular even at the start of the war, and he's certainly not popular now. I mean, the South don't like him because they're secessionists. The North don't like him because he's Hardy, so he's not going to get voted in. So he knows that the minute there's an election, he's going to lose power. So the UN peace talks in Geneva were meant to start in November. It's already December. They've been put off, and various newspapers have reported that the obstacle is Hardy because he won't go to the negotiations because he knows that as soon as peace is negotiated, he'll no longer be president. And he likes being president of a country that's been destroyed, obviously. So that's my little story, which is rather depressing. We'd be happy if you wanted to make any comments. I know that we've got one or two people who know Yemen in the audience. Or if you want to ask any questions. Except it has been used by Saudi Arabia as the excuse. I think that there were links between the Houthis and Iran, but before the war actually started, because when the Houthis were actually controlling Sana'a, they had started flights to Tehran, and Tehran was flying back. I don't think that they've supplied Yemen with a great many weapons. And before the war, I think Yemen was something like, it had something like it was number 16 or something like that of the list of countries with munitions. Anyways, it was the 16th most heavily armed country in the world, so it had a phenomenal lot of munitions. So I don't think it needed to buy munitions before the war. It may indeed want to provide munitions to Yemen now, but I think it's very difficult because of the blockade. But I think that any munitions that it's provided are very minor by comparison to the amount that the West is providing to Saudi Arabia and the Gulf allies. They haven't really had a very big political part in Yemen, and I think that their main reason in showing rhetoric towards Yemen is so that they can use it as a bargaining chip for their own, for example, in the nuclear negotiations and lifting embargo. So they're using Yemen as a bargaining chip rather than being actively involved, because, you know, they're actively involved in Syria, and, you know, they can't be extended more than they are. So I think the role is very slow.
It was interesting, Judith, because there was a photograph of a beautiful island called Socotra.
Yeah.
I think you said you've been there, because it's absolutely gorgeous. And that's where the United States want to build their air base.
Yes, there is. The island of Socotra is actually nearer to Africa than it is to Yemen, but it's a Yemeni island, and when you go there, it has definitely got a Yemen characteristic. It's been cut off from the world because it has very high winds and very high seas around it, and for many years, in fact, when we went there in 1999, wasn't it? It was they'd just built a runway. They hadn't built an airport yet, but it was the first time they had flights in there. And we were actually met by the Minister of Tourism because we were the first tourists to the island. And we went there because we thought we'd go there for the millennium, because we thought the whole world might collapse with the computers and the culture wouldn't. It is a sort of like a very beautiful island, and because of its isolated position, it's got a unique flora and fauna. It's got sort of a lot of species that don't exist anywhere else, and it's a UNESCO site, you know, ecological site. One of the top 10 in the world, but I think the Americans want to build, I think, both a naval base and an air base there in the future. I don't know why it needs to build more. Has it got 600 already?
They acknowledge 630. I think they're about 1,000.
Yeah, so they've got so many bases all over the world. I'm not sure why they need to spoil Socotra, but. But yeah, and of course, some people think that it's their interest in Socatra that the Americans are sort of like driving the Saudis to carry on bombing. You know, I almost think it's almost like it's a new sort of war in Yemen, because the Americans and the British know that their public don't have a thirst for war anymore. I mean, it's obvious that's the case. And to get public consent for war is very difficult. But if you use a non-democratic country to fight and then keep it out of the media, then it means that none of us know what's happening. We've got 150 military personnel in Riyadh helping the Saudis with their operations. They say to help them make the operations more precise, so I don't know whether they need to bomb people's homes more precisely. I'm not quite sure why. But we've got 150 people there. I mean, you wouldn't believe it, but during this war, Saudi Arabia has actually been appointed to head the Human Rights Commission, which is like quite incredible. They are now in charge of any investigations into any the war wrongdoings in Yemen. The Netherlands tried to get an independent investigation, but together with the French and the British and the states in the coalition, they managed to get it thrown out. Apparently, America was minded to go for an independent inquiry, so it was the British and the French that stopped it from happening.
A three-part question. Firstly, is the Oman involved in this in any way? Secondly, do the Adus exist? The Adu, the ex-communists from North Yemen?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. And also, have the Russians still got naval base in Adan City? They used to have, I don't know. As Soviets, they were there.
Yeah. That's quite right. There was a lot of contact with the Russians until 1990, but I don't think that any are there. I think that the Russians have been warning the South that if they have independence and they become a separate country, that they'll have a big debt. So it may be that if they've got a big debt, they might use that pressure to put more air bases there, but I don't think that they've got much involvement. The Southern Communist Movement, which interestingly, before the war, did have a lot of links with Iran, far more than the Houthis.
This goes back to the 60s.
So the Southern Secessionists and Iran had big links. I think those links don't exist now, because I think that the war has actually severed them, as far as I know. There are some sort of like communists in the South, in the secessionist movement, but they don't play a very active role at all. Unfortunately, in a sense, because they did do wonders for the education and the hospital systems in Yemen, and Yemen does need that. And the other part of the question, the first one that you asked.
Oman
actually has been, it's the only GCC country that hasn't joined the coalition against Yemen, and it's remaining neutral. There is a feeling that that was purposeful, because if they remained neutral, then they would have like a country that where they could go for talks, which could was seen as a sort of like somebody who didn't have any interest in the war.
They have in a way, because I believe they've still got territorial claims on some South Yemen.
They may well do. And in fact, I think some people think that Yemen could have territorial claims in Oman.
Well, that's what the war was all about in the 70s.
Yeah. But I think that at the moment, Yemen is playing quite a neutral role. It's not... I think it's behaving quite well, and also making quite a lot of money, because...
Well, I think waiting for it all to collapse as well. Mm-hmm. I think waiting for it all to collapse as well.
Yes, I think so. And also, any Yemeni who travels through Yemen to catch catch a plane has to pay £300, $300 for the visa. So any Yemenis that are managing to escape from Yemen across land through Oman are...
Salah's not very far from there, is it?
Not very far, no. So, and Salalah's got an airport, and that's where people sort of like booking to go from Yemen to Salalah. I think that route now is getting much more difficult because of the Al-Qaeda control of Hadramaut. But I think that they were allowing people to escape, and they did have a full quota of Yemeni people, as many as they could cope with every day, each paying $300, so they made quite a lot of money out of the escape. And they have offered asylum to a few people as well, but comparatively small.
Is there any international recognition that people from Yemen can be judged as genuine refugees?
I haven't heard it, no. No, I mean, it's quite incredible because people say we're going to accept Syrians. In the UN Security Council, they say this war is much, much worse than Syria. And yet nobody has said that Yemenis can actually be offered refuge. And the people that I know that have gone to Malaysia have to work when they're there. They're not allowed to actually claim refugee status there. They're not accepting refugee status, which I think that a lot of Yemenis want, because the thing is, they have to find work within 3 months of getting to Malaysia, and it's quite difficult because with the huge influx of Yemenis, there's a lot of people competing in a small pool for jobs. And so after 3 months, what they have to do is leave Malaysia to go to somewhere like Indonesia and come back so that they've got another 3 months visa. So obviously that's quite expensive, and a lot of people there are struggling for money and they haven't got work. So I think a lot of people wish that they could get refugee status in Malaysia, but they're not automatically giving it, although they are allowing people to go there.
It's interesting, there's a long historical link between the Hadramaut and the east, the west coast of Malaysia, and all the Singaporeans who were of Arab origin come from the Hadramaut.
Yes.
And they came and they basically sat there in ships and then came ashore and just found work and now part of the population.
Yeah, there are. Yeah, those links are really well established in Hadramaut. Yeah.
So there's not too much fighting going on in the Hadramaut.
No, well, there have been a few bombs, and the Americans are still... This is the bizarre thing. Americans are still doing their drone attacks there of Al-Qaeda, even though it's totally ineffective. The numbers are sort of like going up so dramatically. But the Americans are still doing drone attacks, which is just bizarre. I mean, you can't understand the thinking of these people to have, you know, they don't tie in, do they? The policies don't sort of like, you know, tie up, the sort of like loose strands. There have been a few bombs, and I think that's where some people think that they're territory fights between ISIS and Al-Qaeda, and other people think that it's territory fights between the Yemeni army that's in Hadramaut and Al-Qaeda. So there have been a few of those. But then what they have had is this incredible cyclone. I mean, it's just amazing, as if Yemen didn't need anything else. They had two incredible cyclones about 3 weeks ago, two straight after each other, and they never, ever have cyclones, because the Yemeni army is tied up, and so a lot of the south coast of Yemen and Socotra have just been, you know, totally destroyed by the cyclone, so as if they didn't have enough to suffer. Now, Hadramaut, which was the one bit that wasn't suffering war, actually has got a lot of damage from the water. I think they had as much water in a day as they would normally have in 10 years or something.
What questions would you like us to ask of the British government, RFP? And what action would you like the British government to take?
I think that's a really interesting question. I think, first of all, there's been one question which I've been repeatedly asking my MP, who then sends it to Tobias Elwood and sends a letter back which doesn't answer my question. What I want to know is, stage 5 famine is the worst stage of famine. This part of Yemen, nearly all of it, is stage 4. And I think it's at stage 5, but they're just not acknowledging it. Everybody is saying that 85% of Yemenis need humanitarian aid. The UN have put out a request for $1.6 billion, of which they've received a fraction. I'm saying, why don't they put out a DEC appeal? Because there can't be anything worse than this. You know, it's a total disaster. People are dying. And it's, how can you have, they're dying from starvation, they're dying from war, they're dying from diseases, they're dying from dehydration. I mean, they're just dying. So I think that if we had a DEC appeal, it would, A, give some money and also highlight. And I've not yet, from Tobias Elwood, I've also written to the DEC committee to ask, and they haven't given me an answer. So I want to know why we don't have a DEC appeal, because I think you have publicity as well as having money, which would be a two-pronged affair. I've also pointed out to my government that their assistance to Saudi Arabia is inappropriate. Of course, what you do have, which they hide behind all the time, is Security Council Resolution 2216. Now, the Saudis started bombing in March this year, and it wasn't until, I think, the 17th of April, I might have the date slightly wrong, but it was sort of like nearly a month later that they actually went to the Security Council. Would you believe that the Security Council commended the Arab coalition for attacking Yemen and condemned the Houthis and said that they had to, you know, go back to their ancestral home, of which there's none of it left now, but that's by the by. So it was a very one-sided UN Security Council, and the difficulty is this: if you say to them, why are you helping Saudi Arabia, they say 2216. But there are various things, because I think that the Philip Hammond said that if there were evidence of human rights abuses, that they would stop supplying weapons. There is now evidence of human rights abuses with British weapons. They found fragments of British weapons in civilian sites that have killed civilians, and yet they still haven't have declined to have a investigation. What's been shown is that they're using illegal ones like cluster bombs. Of course, what they say is they're provided by Brazil and America that aren't party to cluster bomb treaty, and Saudi isn't party. But that doesn't matter, they're still illegal, even though they haven't ratified that treaty. And so they're using them widely, especially in Saada area. And also in Yemen on the 20th of May, there was something that looked like a nuclear explosion. Now, I actually had tried to get some journalists to go and look and see if they could find any evidence on that, but they weren't able to come back. But in the last week, I've heard of another person who, through an academic, has actually been able to get samples from the crater, which have actually been positive for nuclear residue in the crater. And also, there's some evidence that they're trying to get out of the hospital's medical reports, which they won't release because they say that at the moment, because they say that they're confidential, which actually are children who are suffering from some of the side effects of nuclear radiation, like rashes and hair loss, etc.
Could the cyclones be the result?
Well, I think that's a fair point. So, that's exactly what I've said. I said, isn't it strange that they've had these cyclones when no country has had this amount of ordnance dropped on it in such a short time? Is it affecting climate change? But to go back, I think one of the things that you can really challenge the government on is the human rights issue, to get them to agree to an independent investigation of human rights, and if it's proved. What they say is that they wouldn't supply weapons to Saudi if what it's doing with British weapons is against human rights. and they're keeping a close relationship with Saudi Arabia, and so that Saudi Arabia will tell them if they're doing it. I mean, it's just amazing, isn't it? I mean, it wouldn't be enough to make you laugh if it wasn't enough to make you weep. I mean, it's just crazy. So that's a point to press, I think. You know, the climate change issue. Well, all wars are an issue of climate change, you know?
Although, in fact, I mean, the Oman gets a cable really heavy
time. Yes, it does.
I was there in 1983, and it was a dreadful one.
Yeah.
And recently in 2005.
Yeah.
So they do occasionally get that person.
Yeah.
I mean,
but they don't go as far as Yemen.
When one happened in 1983, they had more rain in that time than for 7 years.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Maybe the climate change is forcing this up. I don't know.
Well, they said this is the worst cyclone in 50 years, so that's, pretty bad, really. Yeah, but yes, around the port, the one that you talked about earlier, that's where they have the rain in the summer, don't they?
Yes, the picture of the Yemen doesn't catch it.
No.
Yes. I still don't understand the ferocity of the Saudi attack. Although I'm still unclear about the geopolitics of it. Why are they doing this, and why is it being supported by so many countries or so better? Why is blitzkrieg on this poor little country?
I know.
Is this something to do with the new king in Saudi Arabia? I was just trying to ask myself, what's the new guy coming? He's king's like a mark.
Yeah.
He's got all his toys to play with. He's got as many toys as he wants. He's got lots of money. He's just taking it out on the neighbours.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think what you're saying, having said that, before King Salman came into power, last year, Saudi topped the list of weapons purchases. So I think that they had it in mind that their weapons purchases increased so dramatically last year that I think they had it in mind that they were going to do something with those weapons. But they had a new monarchy at the beginning of the year, King Salman. And King Salman's actually changed the hereditary system for inheriting the monarchy, because until he came on the throne, the system was that after somebody died, all the monarchy got together and decided who the next leader was going to be. It might have been somebody that was already an heir apparent, but he wasn't sort of like named as such. Well, what King Salman's done is named his nephew and his and one of his sons as the heir apparent, so he's actually named his heirs now and said that they're going to follow him. And one of which, the youngest one, who's I think he's about. Well, some people say he's told. They say that he's 32, but a lot of people believe that he's actually 28, and they've exaggerated his age to make him seem a bit more acceptable. But he's really sort of, you know, he's like a child with a toy, really, and he's orchestrating the campaign on Yemen, and it's completely uninhibited. But of course, it can be uninhibited. There's no media there. There's no world telling them not to do it. There's no investigation. So they are very. It's just incredible what's happening.
One of the things I'm just wondering, could they be using Yemen as a test site for new weaponry?
I'm sure they are.
Because it would be very convenient to all these countries that are providing weaponry, that are making money out of weaponry, to have somewhere where they can test it all out.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and I think that happens in a lot of wars. You know, I think they probably want to test out some wars with ISIS in Syria, and the Israelis do a bit of testing out in Gaza. You know, so I think that does happen in war.
What's Egypt's attitude? In fact, back in the 60s. Egypt invaded. It was invited in by the Marxists.
Yes, it was.
Killed the revolutionaries.
Yeah.
Egyptians killed everything.
What
do the Yemenis think of that period? What do they think about the Egyptians?
Well, I mean, in the past, some people have said, and they've laughed and they said, well, actually, it was an Egyptian invasion. But of course, Egypt got burned more than Yemen because, I mean, a lot of people think that the reason it lost the Six-Day War was because it was involved in this messy confrontation with Yemen at the time of the first revolution when the monarchy was driven out. So Egypt have been burned in Yemen. Now, it's quite interesting, you see, because the role of Egypt is it's the one country that is really not saying what it's doing. It's actually, as said time and time again, that we are supporting the Saudi Arabia, and then leaving it at that, not saying how. So there have been rumours that they've sent in some ground forces, and there have been rumours that they've got, I think, two planes in the aerial bombardment. But Egypt has not confirmed it, and it's the only country that hasn't confirmed what they're doing in Yemen. So, yeah, they obviously sort of like are a little bit wary of getting involved in Yemen, and a bit wary of their own people knowing that they're getting involved in Yemen as well.
Because they're effectively defeated by the Yemen. The Marxist revolution failed. A lot of people say that because of the Egyptian involvement.
Well, other people say that it's because Salah killed the Marxist president. But, you know, there you go. And a lot of people in Yemen thought that the one that Salah killed to take over was actually the best president that Yemen didn't keep. But they'd had a succession of presidents being killed at that point. Yeah.
It's a very short question. Most people probably already know the answer, but I'm not quite lined up around Saudi Arabia getting involved with Israel, because what about Gaza? I mean, I'm just, what's the...
That's the bizarre thing, isn't it? Because if you were going to protect a nation, surely you would be going to protect the Palestinians, not
because
going in to protect I'm not sure who they thought they were protecting in Yemen, Hadi and his government. But yes, you would have thought they would have protected Palestine. So it just seems like very strange that that the GCC countries have had close relationships with Saudi Arabia. But, you know, I mean, I noticed sort of like about 5 years ago that there was a French country company. It's actually registered in France, but it's actually an Israeli company. Mm-hmm. Everybody knows that it's actually Israeli, even though it's registered in France. And I noticed that about 5 years ago, a Saudi company joined up with that Israeli company. Well, they knew it was Israeli. They knew it was a French brand. So, you know, there have been sort of like a lot of sort of like commercial links with Israel over quite a long time. And it is very surprising, but it doesn't seem at all logical, does it? But, yeah.
Is that to do with the sort of different factions of Islam?
No.
It's not nothing to do with.
I think that. Don't think so. But it's quite interesting because Netanyahu made a speech, I think it was about a week ago, when he talked about extending the state of Israel into Yemen. And he said that he could do it cheaper because he said they managed to control all of the Palestinians for $4 million aid that they get from the Americans. And it's going to cost a lot more than that to control Yemen. So they think that they could actually control Yemen much more cheaply than any other country.
So, Is that a joke or what?
I don't know, but it was reported in various newspapers.
They used the Yemeni Jews to do the dirty work for it.
Well, the Yemeni Jews, of course, have all been driven out.
Yeah.
And the last ones, because after the Saada War, when the Houthis militias had started, and they were started, I mean, at that point in the 1990s, obviously Hezbollah had just defeated the Israelis, and it was held in big esteem in the Arab world. So. So the Houthi militias had a lot of links with Hezbollah. They did some training with them. They saw them as their mentors, if you like. And after that, when they came back, the biggest population of Jews left in Yemen was actually in Saada, where they've been living for generations. And then they became under threat from the new regime of the Houthis, you know, death to Israel dealt with Jews sort of thing. So they were put under threat, and they were rescued by Salah, who moved them into an area near to Sana and gave them protection. I thought that they'd left. There aren't that many of them left now. But there was an article in the newspaper the other day saying that they... that these Jews were sort of like, were saying that they didn't want to leave Yemen and that they were being persecuted. So the remaining Jews there are being persecuted. So, this is what's so sad, because the Jewish community over most of the Middle East were very prominent in society. In the house that I lived in Sana'a, in an area called Alka, was actually the Jewish quarter, and my house used to be a Jewish house. And they were sort of like the artisans. There was a street near to me which still does jewelry and clothes. And that was because, you know, the Jewish community were the ones who did the clothes and jewelry. And although they're importing the jewelry and the clothes now, but they're still in that street, Jamal Street. So the evidence of, you know, you could see this sort of like the Star of David in the Gomorrahs over the windows. So it was a very vibrant Jewish community. I mean, it was a disaster when it went really.
And the Jews that are in Israel now are second-class citizens.
Yeah, well, particularly, you know, the Yemeni community, the Yemeni Jewish community. They were one of the very, very oldest Jewish communities in the world, and they kept their papers and their family papers with them. When they went into Israel, they had all of those taken off them because they said, oh, we can keep them safe for you. I mean, they kept these papers with all of their family sort of like history for 1,000 years or more. So why couldn't they? I mean, you couldn't say that they wouldn't safeguard them because they already had. But they took them off them, and some of them have appeared in American universities, for example, where they were obviously sold on to the highest bidder. So it really is very, very sad. And of course, the thing is, because most of them, well, they were bullied into leaving Yemen. They actually sent rabbis over to demonstrate to them that it was their duty as Jews to actually leave and travel to Israel, because obviously the European Jews wanted some sort of like lower class Jews to do their menial tasks, and that was what they did. So they weren't happy when they went there, but of course they didn't go there with a passport, so they hadn't got a Yemeni passport, and they couldn't come back. So it was, and there were lots of interviews with Yemeni Jews who really regretted going. Of course now they're probably pleased.
Adam asked about the geopolitical interests. Adam asked about the geopolitical interests. Well, I can remember seeing reports. One was on Al Jazeera back in, it might have been March, a bit before that. One from Dr. Saeed Shath, who is a political analyst and things. And he was saying that very much the bombing started to coincided with the fact that the Houthis were making quite significant gains against Al-Qaeda in Yemen. Obviously, Al-Qaeda in Yemen is funded quite a lot by Saudi Arabia, the same sort of Wahhabist ideology. And he gave that report. There was also quite an extensive report on Al Jazeera about particular battles that the Houthis had made significant gains against Al-Qaeda. And then there was another film, and they were showing these Houthis saying, oh, Al-Qaeda are there. They seem to be really making quite a lot of gains. And then Saudi Arabia comes in. As you say, it's all probably tied in with Hardy running over to Saudi Arabia as well. But, you know, do you think that the fact that the Houthis were defeating Saudi Arabia's Al-Qaeda to a large degree in Yemen was a contributing factor?
It's quite interesting in that province because it's very tribal, because the people there, the tribes there, felt that it was their right to guard the oil installations, but Salah had actually brought in northern tribesmen, his henchmen, to actually to look after the oil installations as the security, which had already created the tension. The thing in Yemen is that all the militias can be Al Qaeda one day and tribes the next, or Houthi one day and Baqir tribe the next. Everyone morphs from tribe to sort of like to militias. So therefore, it's very, you know, Al Qaeda can get bigger if it needs to, the Houthis can get bigger, and in the same way, they can get smaller. I think one of the difficulties there is that if you can say that the Houthis can have one battle against Al Qaeda and win, and there have been significant battles, and they have won them. But I think that what you're talking about is tribal warfare, and if one side appears to be winning sort of like decisively, it actually pulls more militias into that group. So what it ends up is sort of tribal warfare under the name of the Houthis and Al Qaeda, if you know what I mean. So I think that it's very difficult to say that the Houthis on their own could defeat Al Qaeda. It's very difficult to actually say that that can happen. And they can win battles, they can win areas, but the difficulty is that if people think that the Houthis northerners are getting too big for their boots in Marib, which is central, well, or more or less central Yemen, it'll actually attract more people in to support Al Qaeda in that particular area. So, I mean, what you need is actually peace. And I think that given that the tribes, I think Al Qaeda is almost exclusively a Yemen entity in Yemen. I don't think that they're importing people from outside. There are a few that came back from the Afghan war, but almost exclusively it's a Yemen entity. It's a tribal entity. And so my feeling when the Americans started bombing Al Qaeda, I mean, at that time, you could count the amount of Al Qaeda operatives on your hand that were known, that were considered dangerous. The bombing of the Americans actually increased the number of Al-Qaeda, dramatically increased it, because they were killing so many civilians. And so I think that, and of course a lot of eloquent Yemenis had actually said so when it got, one was imprisoned, another one at age 24 died in mysterious circumstances. And of course Al-Waliki, when I went to the meeting here, if you remember, I mean, they called him head of Al-Qaeda. He wasn't. He wasn't head of Al-Qaeda. The chap who was head of Al-Qaeda, ever since it started in Yemen, was killed in about April this year. So they named this American head of Al-Qaeda in order to give them the right to go in and kill him, and then 2 weeks later go in and kill his son. So if you're trying to agitate against drones, and Al-Waliki was trying to recruit to Al-Qaeda, but it was the drones that made him want to recruit. No. So therefore, what I'm saying is, what you need to be doing is to be negotiating with the tribe. For example, in Jar yesterday in Abyan province, Al Qaeda took over the city, but their tribal leaders, the tribe that these people belong to, actually went to see them and said, "No, don't go into Jar," and they actually left. They walked out. So what I'm saying is, they're only tribesmen. They've got a franchise of Al-Qaeda that they take up every now and then, and the same with the Houthis as well. What you need to do is to look at those tribes and look at their genuine grievances. And certainly in Marib province and in lots of other provinces, the issue is that they want to guard the oil installations and get paid for it. They don't want Saleh's cronies to come in from North Yemen to guard their oil installation. And that is their grievance. So if you dealt with that grievance, then there would be less Al Qaeda activity in Mali.
Any more questions?
What proportion of British arms go to Saudi Arabia? Saudi Arabia gets their arms, I imagine, mainly to the States, but we obviously make a contribution. You know.
Yeah, I, to be honest, I don't know. There was a report to say that that they are diverting a lot of missiles that were intended for the RAF to Saudi to help in their war effort, but I'm not sure how many. But I think at the end of the year, you know, when the reports are done, you'll actually see it. But at the moment, I don't think that I know.
So when and how is it all going to end?
I think it's going to go on for a long time. I mean, I think it's sad, but I think it is going to go on for a long time. Tayyip's people are saying they're not going to accept anything other than a military defeat. And it's at stalemate that Tayyip isn't going to be taken militarily. So I just think it's going to go on forever and ever, and, you know, maybe as long as the Iran-Iraq war, for example. Because the thing is, even if the Saudis stop bombing tomorrow, and the Saudis might be persuaded to stop bombing, but even if the Saudis stop bombing tomorrow, there's been enough internal sort of like hatred built up because of this war in Yemen that you've actually got this momentum for people fighting within Yemen, you know. So stopping the Saudis bombing isn't going to stop war any more than stopping the British bombing is going to stop the war in Syria.
Very, very, very interesting. Very depressing, but very interesting. Thank you very much indeed, Judith.
Thank you.